Welcome to Preaching That Matters, a place you can find apostolic Pentecostal preaching, a place where all generations can be fed with the Word of God. We hope you enjoy.
Hallelujah. I wonder if we could love Him together with all of our hearts. There is a deep current of the Holy Ghost that's moving all across this building right now. I want to tap into what God has for me tonight. Hallelujah. Young person, you don't have to leave tonight without being renewed in the Holy Ghost. You don't have to leave tonight without speaking in tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. Acts 3:19 says, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." Amen. That's what we're experiencing right now in this place. It's a time of refreshing. It's a time of renewing. It's a time of the Holy Ghost touching and strengthening us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't want to miss an opportunity to be renewed in my mind, to be renewed in my heart, to be renewed in my spirit. Hallelujah. 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 My God, there is a powerful touch of the Holy Ghost in this place tonight. Hallelujah. I prayed earlier. I said, God, don't let me stand in the way of what you want to do in this place tonight. I don't ever want to stand in the way of what God wants to do by a moving and administration power of the Holy Ghost that touches us, that strengthens us, that renews us, that allows our hearts to be strengthened by Him. Amen. God bless you for standing. You may be seated. I don't want to take away from what God is doing, but I felt this song on my heart before I came up here tonight. So if you don't mind, I'm going to sing real quick. See what God would touch and minister and strengthen every single one of us. There's a song that just says, I will be what you've called me to be. I'll say yes. Lord, I agree. My desire passionately is to be what you've called what I'll be. Say, I will be what you've called me to be. I'll say this your prayer. I'll say yeah. I mean, if there's a young person in this house, that's your prayer tonight. I wonder if you could stand to your feet. Every person in this house, reach up your hands and say, God, I want to be what you've called me to be. God, I want to be obedient. I want to respond to your voice. I want to respond to your calling, God. I don't want to hold anything back. God, I'm willing to be everything that you called me to be. Everything, God, that you intended for me to be. I'm willing to be obedient tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm going to direct our attention to the book of Galatians chapter 4 tonight. I believe God is calling young people. God is calling young adults. God is calling youth. God is calling families. God is calling elders. But I believe especially tonight, I have a burden for our young people to see God's desire revealed, His will revealed in your lives, to see Him strengthen, to touch, to minister, and to move. If you've grown cold in your spirit, tonight's the night to let that soul be caught on fire by the power of the Holy Ghost. If you've become indifferent, it's time to dive headlong into the depths of God's glory and of His power. I mean, it's not time to stand on the fringes. It's not time to stand on the fence and look in and observe what others are experiencing in God, but it's time for us to dive into the depths of the riches of God's glory. Deep is calling unto deep tonight. Hallelujah. I believe there's a depth that God wants us to experience in the power of the Holy Ghost. And give honor to the leadership of this church, to our great pastor and his family, our bishop and his family. And I am thankful we are so blessed here at ILC. Amen. We don't know really how good we have it. We are so, so, so blessed here to have a church, to have the leadership, to have the pastor, the shepherd that God has placed in our lives. And I am so thankful for what God is doing in the Inland Empire. Galatians chapter 4, verse number 1, the Bible says, "Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so, we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ." For the next little bit, with the help of the Lord, I want to preach on the Spirit of adoption. The Spirit of adoption. I mean, let's ask that God would touch us one more time in this service. God, we worship you. God, we feel your presence. We feel your Spirit moving so beautifully and powerfully in this place. God, we're powerless without you. Without an intervention of the Holy Ghost, we need your Spirit. We need your power. We need your touch, oh God. We need you to speak to our hearts. Anoint us tonight, God. Equip us with your word. Write it upon the tables of our heart tonight, God. Fill us so full of your Spirit, God, that it leaves room for nothing else in this world. I pray that you would strengthen us. Touch us tonight. Touch us, God, by the power of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' precious name. And everyone shouted amen. Amen. God bless you for standing. You may be seated. His name is Jordan. He is 9 years old. He and his brother Brayson have been wards of the state of Oklahoma in the foster care system for the past several years. At one point, Jordan was separated from his brother to live in a different group home. Eventually, that brother was adopted to a family, while Jordan remained separated from his brother in the foster care system. During an interview, he was asked, "If you could go anywhere in the world, where would it be?" He replied, "To an adoption party for a home." He later was asked, "If you had 3 wishes, what would those wishes be?" He didn't even have to think about it, but promptly replied, "To have a family. All he truly wanted in his life was normalcy and a parent's unconditional love. One of the last things he said during this interview when given a chance to speak was, "I hope one of y'all pick me." Can you imagine being in that state? There are more than 9,000 children in the state of Oklahoma in the foster care system, and over 400,000 children in the foster care system nationwide. Adoption, when we look at it in the natural, is a very powerful process, especially for a child that's looking for the nurture and the love of 2 parents. But when we look at it, even in a spiritual context tonight, of God adopting us to be his children, it's made even more powerful when we understand that he loved us who were unlovable. He loved us who were born in sin and shapen in iniquity. And he said, "I want that child to be mine. I want them to be called a child of the King. And I'm going to reach down and I'm going to pull them out of a world of darkness. I'm going to bring them into the light and I'm going to show them and to reveal them the beauty of my ways and of my Spirit." Adoption is a beautiful process. It is truly the heart of the gospel and what is one of the primary themes of the New Testament when we look as we, people who are enslaved under the law of sin, are brought out of that law of sin and into the light of God's word and of his gospel through the power of adoption and of his redemption. Adoption is a powerful work. We look at the word of God and we understand that Moses was adopted by one of Pharaoh's daughters who saved him from being destroyed with the other Hebrew male infants. However, Moses had to reach a point in his life. Do I choose to live in this palace, wear these beautiful clothes, and eat of the finest foods in the world? or do I choose to suffer the afflictions of my people rather than enjoying the pleasures of sin for a season? Thank God he made that choice and went on to become one of the greatest and meekest leaders that this world has ever known. A while ago, I heard an artist's depiction of Pharaoh's daughter describing all of the carnal and earthly goals that she had for her adopted son, while his real mother was praying for all the spiritual goals that she wanted to see fulfilled in Moses' life. Now, I know that's not doctrine, but it definitely gives you pause to think about Pharaoh's daughter wanting him to be all of these things. She wanted him to be powerful. She wanted him to grow up and do all of these carnal things in the world, while a mother who hid him in a basket because she wanted to preserve him, not fully knowing at that time the power that God was going to instill in Moses and the magnitude of the leadership that he was going to bring, put him and hid him so that he might be preserved and might be able to lead and fulfill a cause in the kingdom of God. Ephraim and Manasseh were adopted. Essentially, they were Jacob's grandsons. But he says in Genesis 48, he says, I'm going to treat them as if they're my own sons. As Simeon and as Reuben, I'm going to treat Ephraim and Manasseh. Samuel was dedicated to God by his mother Hannah through a promise that she made, and he was brought under the leadership of Eli. Esther, a girl who was orphaned after her parents' death, was adopted by her cousin Mordecai. Even the child Christ Jesus had an earthly father named Joseph. And so when we look at the theme of adoption throughout the Word of God, we understand that the reason that he came was to give us the spirit of adoption. That is the central reason why God robed himself in flesh and dwelt among us, was to give us the power of the Holy Ghost, the power of his spirit to dwell within us. When we look at adoption, there are five powerful aspects I want to talk about tonight. The first aspect is adoption is a planned and a deliberate process. Adoption doesn't just happen by accident. To adopt a child, the parents must be willing to go through a deliberate process. They must learn and become educated about the process. They must select an adoption agency, complete a home study, search for a child, exchange information with the agency, wait for the selected child, meet and visit the prospective child, receive a placement date, finalize the adoption, and then finally, after this entire process is fulfilled, that child goes to live with their adoptive family. It is a planned process. It's a long process sometimes, but the process of being adopted into the kingdom of God is not an arduous or a long process. Tonight, God can complete that process in you if you don't have the Holy Ghost and that spirit of adoption living in you. It is a purposeful process. It is a planned process. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ himself according to the good pleasure of his will. It's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come unto repentance. It's not his will that any should die under the weight of sin in their life, but that all should be brought out of that world of sin and experience the power and the process of adoption. It was a deliberate process. The Bible says Jesus Christ was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. He was already in the mind and the thought of God to create a redemption plan through the shedding of blood. At the end of the Old Testament, it is described that there was no remedy for the sin problem that existed there. Mary's conception was not an accident, but that which was conceived in her was of the Holy Ghost. Bethlehem was a deliberate process and represented the birth of a remedy. Gethsemane was a deliberate process in that it represented the submission of the will of man to the will of God. Calvary was a deliberate process and represented the death of the old man through the process of repentance. It represented redemption, atonement, and justification for our sins. It was a deliberate process. The burial of Jesus Christ in a borrowed tomb was a deliberate process and represented the burial of the old man in baptism, under the water of baptism. The resurrection of Jesus Christ was a deliberate process and represented the ability for us to rise and walk in newness of life. Behold, all things are passed away. All things are become new. Even as the ascension of Jesus Christ is described in Scripture, we understand that one day we're going to rise as He rose and meet Him in the air. I have a hope and I have a calling as a result of the deliberate process that Jesus Christ created for me to follow. It didn't happen by accident. And people receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost is not just an accident. It doesn't just take someone off their feet and knock them off to the side but without them even knowing what's going on. But it's a deliberate process that we follow. We go through the burial of baptism in Jesus' name. We go through the death of repentance and turning away from the things in our lives. And in doing so, we receive the spirit of adoption in our lives. And that's not a one-time thing, but God wants it to be a continual process in each and every one of us. Young men, it's got to be something that's cultivated within us. Paul told Timothy, stir up the gift of God that is within you. You've got to stoke the fire of the Holy Ghost stirred in your spirit and in your heart. Young ladies, we've got to pray and seek after God and say, God, let that gift be stirred up within me. The process of the spirit of adoption working in me. Renewal doesn't just happen by accident, but it is a deliberate process. The second aspect of adoption tonight is adoption is a costly process. It's a very costly process, both financially and emotionally. In looking at some statistics, the financial cost of an adoption typically ranges from $25,000 to $50,000 per child. Not accounting for the $200,000 to over $250,000 that it takes to raise one child and send them through college. The process is also very time-consuming, requires unwavering commitment on behalf of the parents. While adoption could cost us significant amounts of time and emotions in the natural, it cost Jesus Christ His very life. And all God is asking for in return is our will, our desires, our emotion, our heart, our time. God is asking for those things. He says, I gave my life for you. What more could I give? All I'm asking for is a broken and a contrite spirit that's willing to follow after my will and my word. But it's a costly process. Calvary for us is a costly process because we have to lay down our own desires. We have to lay down our will and our ambition. We have to lay down our goals and say, God, I'm willing to set these things aside and set my focus on what you want for me. Sometimes we count the cost. We believe it's too much. But tonight I believe I'm in a building with a group of people that don't believe that it's too costly to live for God, that we're willing to lay aside everything in our lives to say, God, it was a costly process for you, and I'm going to allow it to be a costly process for me. I don't have much to give in terms of finance to you, God. I may not even have much talent and ability to give to you, but I'm going to give you the very thing that I have, and that's the center of my will and of my emotions. I'm going to give you my spirit, and I'm going to give you my soul. Take me, God, and spend me as currency in your kingdom. How many want to be spent as currency in the kingdom of God and say, God, I'm willing to lay down my life. You laid down your life for me, so I'm willing to do it for the sake of the gospel and of the kingdom. The third aspect of adoption that I want to talk about tonight is adoption involves a change in the legal status of a child. Galatians 4 and 6, the Bible says, and because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. We understand that servants and slaves were not allowed to refer to the master of the house as Father or Abba. Only children, either blood-related or adopted, were then allowed to refer to them as Father or Abba. an intimate term of relationship. And when we receive the adoption, the spirit of adoption in our lives, then we can call him Abba. We can call him Father. We have a heavenly Father when we receive that spirit of adoption. We can reach out and say, God, I've got a Father in you now. Even though mother and father may forsake me, I know that you are going to uphold me. Though my friends in this world walk away from me, I now have a relationship with a Father that I've never known before. The Bible says in Romans 8 and 15, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. When we receive the Holy Ghost, we are no longer servants or slaves of sin, but we, through that process, become his sons and his daughters, and he becomes our Father. Through that process, we take on his name in baptism. It involves the legal status change of a child when we take on his name. No longer am I a slave or a servant unto sin, but now I take on his name and he changes my status and he becomes my Father and his name becomes written over me. I'm thankful today that through the power of baptism, I can take on his name through the power of his Spirit. We have a relationship with him and we can call him Abba, Father. That's why he says you receive the Spirit crying Abba, Father, understanding that he is now our heavenly Father. He is our heavenly Father. The fourth aspect tonight regarding the process of adoption is adoption is marked by a moral and a spiritual transformation. Now, there are many arguments in this world of what causes a child to become who they are. Is it nature or is it nurture? Is it genetics or just things that they inherit? Or is it the nurture of a home and of a mom and or a dad? You look at genetics, you see children. Oftentimes, children who are adopted out, even when they're newborn, will start to exhibit the behavior of their blood-related parents. I know of a young man right now, and they say he acts just like his parents, and he has never met with them, never been with them, ever. But the parents know the other parents, and they see this young man exhibit the very same behaviors of his blood-related parents. So there is power there in the nature aspect of it. But it doesn't have to stay that way. It doesn't have to all just be nature and inherited traits, but it can be the nurture of the church that can change the very aspect of someone's life. When we come into the kingdom of God, yes, we may have the traits of Adam within us. We may be born in sin and shapen in iniquity, and I may inherit those sinful natures from him. But when I come into the church, there is a moral and a spiritual transformation that happens, and I don't have to follow after those genetic traits. With the nurture of the church, it changes the very behavior and outlook on who I am and who I become. Just because my dad was an alcoholic doesn't mean I need to be an alcoholic. Just because my mom was a thief and a liar doesn't mean I need to become a thief and a liar. The buck stops with you, and there can be moral and spiritual transformation in your life. You may be the only one in your family living for God. You may be the only one in your family that said, I'm going to take a stand and living for God. And that nurture of the church can allow a moral transformation in your life. You don't have to go the way of your parents. You don't have to go the way of your grandparents. But God, through the power and the nurture of his Spirit, through his leadership and guidance as our Father, and through the nurture of the church, can change the very outlook of someone's life. You can break the mold in your family. And not only are you doing it for yourself, but you're doing it for future generations. Those that come after you aren't going to have to fight the same battles that you fought. I don't have to fight the same battles my dad fought, because he chose at a young age to live for God and say, my family's going to live for God. He started going to church when I was 6 months of age, and God beautifully filled him with the Holy Ghost. And because he took a stand for righteousness, he changed the very outlook of my life. Yes, we have to deal with our sinful and our carnal and our moral frailties, but God, through the power of his Spirit, can change the very course of who we are through the nurture of the church and the leadership of his word and the spirit of adoption that works within us. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You don't have to be the same way. You don't have to leave even tonight the very same way that you came. God can transform something in you. You can break that habit, young man. You can break that addiction. You don't have to fight those things late at night when you're the only one who knows. Young lady, you don't have to deal with those things that you're fighting on a day-to-day basis. You can leave changed by the power of the Holy Ghost. Why? Because God wants moral and spiritual transformation to happen as a result of the Word of God working in our lives. The Word is a hammer. The Word is a hammer. And as long as that Word's going forth, it's going to chip away at the hardness of my spirit. It's going to chip away at the hardness of my heart so that it can reach him and that word can be engrafted into the fleshy tables of my heart. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I wonder if we could love him together right now. God can change the very course of your life. You don't have to struggle with that anymore. You don't have to follow after those ways, but you can tonight make a choice and make a difference in your life. You don't have to waver. Which way am I going? Am I going to follow after my worldly friends, or am I going to follow after the church? God, I want to follow after your ways because you want me to be transformed. Hallelujah. Romans 12 says that you need to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The Bible says in Romans 8 and 14, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. I want to be led by the Spirit. I want his Spirit to lead and to guide and to direct every aspect of my life. The Bible says the steps of a good man are ordered of the Lord. And through the Spirit of adoption, he calls us out of the chaos of this world and sets our feet on a path that is clear before us to walk in his ways and in his word. The fifth aspect of adoption, this is something that gives me hope and gives me encouragement tonight. When a child is adopted, they gain the rights to be the heirs of their father's inheritance. With that legal status change also comes an inheritance that they get to take part of. So not only do we get to experience the glory and the infilling and the power of Almighty God down here, but God says, I've got something greater for you. I'm giving you just a taste of glory right now. But one day you're going to experience the fullness of my glory. You're going to experience the fullness of my grace and of my truth. So much so, as Bishop says, it's going to be the absence of everything negative in our lives. And because I'm a child of the King, I get access to the inheritance that he has prepared for me. Romans 8 and 17, the Bible says, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, we may be also glorified together. Because we get to suffer with him, we also get to reap the benefits and the rewards of being glorified together with him. If that doesn't make you want to live for God, I don't know what will. I've got a hope beyond the bounds of this earth. I've got a hope that is beyond the finite bounds of this life. Yes, this life is frail, and every single one of us are going to die. I heard a statistic that said 10 out of 10 people are going to die. Maybe even Pastor said it. Unless God calls us home that way. But because we have the Spirit of adoption, we don't have to go the way of the rest of this world. But we can be transformed and we get to obtain the inheritance that he has for us. Romans 8 and 22, the Bible says, "For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. We ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it." Our souls groan within us, waiting for that final transformation in our lives. It's not a groan of travail. It's not a groan of death, but it is a groan of life that says, "Come, Lord, quickly. I want to see what you have prepared for me beyond the finite bounds of this earth." Our souls groan within us, "Lord, come quickly. Take us all home and give us the reward that you have prepared for us." Why? Because he's given us the inheritance. He's given us access. And while we're waiting down here, he's given us the earnest, the down payment, the deposit on the full inheritance that he has for us. The Bible says in Proverbs 13 and 12, "Hope deferred maketh the heart sick, but when the desire cometh, it is a tree of life." We have a rich Father tonight. When we become his children, we may not have a penny to our name, but guess what? You've been adopted into a family where there's a rich Father. Now, he's not going to just pour out coins and $100 bills from heaven upon you. Maybe in some of your lives it's happened that way. Maybe in some not. But we serve a God and a Father who is rich in love. And Ephesians 2 and 4 describes the richness of his love. We serve a God who is rich in grace, a God who is rich in mercy, a God who is rich in wisdom, and a God who is rich in knowledge. And the Bible talks about the unsearchable riches of his glory and of his power. We understand tonight that we serve a rich God, and it's not all something he's keeping to himself, but he says, "I have this for you. If you want to go through the spirit of adoption, the process of adoption into the kingdom of God, this is something that you get to take advantage of as a child of the King." How unsearchable are his riches. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Every beast of the forest is his, and even the cattle upon 1,000 hills belongs to him. Why would we want to follow after any other father in this world? Why would we want to follow after any other role model or influence in this world when we look at the Word of God and understand the beauty and the richness of our God and what he wants to give unto us? He is the perfect depiction of altruism, because he doesn't just keep it all to himself, but he says it's for you and it's for all that are afar off. If it's to as many as the Lord our God shall call. It's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. As his children, we are heirs to that inheritance. We're heirs to that richness, and all of that belongs to us since we're in his kingdom. The Bible talks about orphans. Many references to the fatherless and the widow in the Word of God. And we understand that all of us under the law of sin will become orphaned. If we're not living for God, having the nurture of the church and the influence of Almighty God in our lives, every single one of us become orphaned. Why? Because sin tries to make you think that it's a good parent. It tries to make you think that it's a good role model in your life. The Bible doesn't say that sin isn't pleasurable, but it says that sin is pleasurable yet for a season. But sin, when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. And when we find out, when we follow after the desires of the flesh, and we follow after the desires of ourselves, yes, it may be pleasurable for a little while, But I've seen it time and time again where that sin, when it's finished, leaves you abandoned and deserted in a gutter somewhere. It leaves you abandoned and deserted, crying yourself to sleep at night, wondering, what am I supposed to do with my life right now? How many can testify that God pulled you out of a world where you were abandoned? You were an orphan one day, neglected by the awful parenting skills of sin. And God said, I'm going to pick you up and I'm going to adopt you into my kingdom. I'm going to adopt you into my family. Yes, you were neglected by this world. Yes, you were forsaken by sin. But though father and mother forsake you, I am going to reach down and I'm going to pick you up and I'm going to bring you under the banner of my love. The Bible says that he cares about the orphans. Psalm 68 and 5 says, a father of the fatherless and a judge of the widows is God in his holy habitation. John 14 and 18, I will not leave you comfortless, but I will come unto you. The God that knows the very number of hairs upon our head, the number of grains of sand beneath the ocean, that sees every single sparrow when it falls in the forest, knows and cares about every single orphan in this world. He cares about the backsliders. He cares about those who have drifted away. He cares about those who've become cold in their spirit. He cares about those who've not gotten the renewing in their mind and their spirit that they need. And we're encumbered about with so many things in this world. There's fear and there's opinion and there's things pulling us to the right and to the left. And oftentimes it becomes chaotic in our minds and our spirits, not knowing how to deal with the things that are hitting us on a day-to-day basis. We live in the age of information. And that information is so plenteous, and it is so prevalent, and it is so argumentative against each other that you don't even know who's speaking truth and who's speaking a lie. You don't know what's opinion and what is fact, and you don't know what's an attitude and what's the truth. That's where you got to shut those things out in your life and say, God, I want to go back to the sacredness of your divine word and of your spirit and of your truth. I don't want to listen to those things. I don't want to be pulled to the left or to the right by those that are trying to convince me that they care more about me than you do. God cares about the fatherless. He cares about the orphaned. Deuteronomy 14 and 29 speaks of what they're supposed to do and to give unto the fatherless and to the widows, so that they may come and eat and be satisfied. Deuteronomy 10 and 18 speaks of the fatherless and the widow, and that he loveth the stranger and giveth to him food and raiment. James 1 and 27 speaks about that we need to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction. And the Bible says in Psalm 27, I've quoted it a few times tonight, when my father and my mother forsake me, then will the Lord take me up. God truly cares about the orphaned, and he cares about the fatherless in our world. Sin is a cruel taskmaster. Sin is a cruel taskmaster. It's a cruel and neglectful parent that leaves its children completely abandoned. But thank God tonight we have the spirit of adoption that works within us. We have the power of Almighty God that wants to change and transform every single one of us. We must all be adopted, but none of us are born naturally into the kingdom of God. The Bible talks about us receiving the power to become the sons of God in John chapter 1. The Bible says, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Every one of us are born under the law of sin. Every one of us are the children of wrath. Ephesians 2 and 3 describes us as by nature the children of wrath. And in order for us to change that within ourselves, we first have to realize I'm a child of wrath. And I've been born in sin and shapen in iniquity, and I've got to do something about it. And that's where it takes us, to the repentance of Calvary and the power of God's Spirit moving and working within us. Don't stray too far away from Calvary. Don't let Calvary become a distant thing in your life, but find yourself continually going back to that altar and saying, God, I'm a child of wrath. I've been born in sin and shapen in iniquity, and I've got to pick myself up every day and take it to an altar and say, today you're going to submit unto the will of God. Today you're going to conform to what God wants for you. Today you're going to pray. Today you're going to fast. And I've got to put these things first in my life and understand that it's not by happenstance or by accident that these things happen. It's got to be something deliberate in your life to draw closer to God. And God says, I'll give you as much as you want from me, as far as you're willing to go. I will allow you to go that far in my kingdom and understand the power of my Spirit and the depths of the riches of my glory. God's willing to go as far as you're willing to go in the kingdom through this process of spiritual infilling. But it's not enough just for us to know Him. There's a movement that just says, I have to accept Him as my Savior. But it doesn't just work out that way. The Bible says in Galatians 4:9, but now after that ye have known God, or rather are known of God. What did He say to that slothful servant? Depart from me, ye worker of iniquity. I never knew you. I never had a relationship with you. I never knew you. So it's not enough for us just to have a mental acknowledgement of God. It's not enough for us just to say, I accept Him, but I want God to know me. I want that relationship to be two ways. I don't want Him to look at the wedding and see someone that snuck in past everyone without the proper wedding garment on, and He walked up to him and said, friend. And it wasn't a term of endearment, but He says, you're an imposter. You're a pretend friend. You made it in here and you didn't have the proper wedding garment on. He didn't know Him. It's not enough just to know God. It's not enough just to know about Him. It's not enough just to have an intellectual acknowledgement or a philosophical description of a higher power or being up there. But we have to know Him. We have to know His name. We have to know the fellowship of His suffering. We have to know Him. Young person, it's not enough just to know and to memorize Scripture, but let it become a part of who you are. Let it change your character. Let it change your being. Let it become a part of who you are, so that when people see you, it's not you, but it's a reflection of Jesus Christ in you. Let it change every aspect of who you are. Saint of God, let it permeate every part and every fiber of your being, so that it transforms you to where it's not just about me anymore, but God, when people look at me, when they're around me, when they experience time with me, let it not just be me, but let it be the power of the Spirit of God moving and working and strengthening me. I want the power of God to emanate from every part of who I am. I want the anointing of God to flow wherever I'm at, whether it's in the boardroom or whether it's in the prayer room. I want the power of God to move and to flow. Every part of who I am, every part of my spirit and of my being, it's got to be permeated and saturated by the glory of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It's not enough just to play pretty. It's not enough just to sing pretty. It's not enough just to speak eloquent words. But it's about us getting the Spirit of God deep within our hearts and our spirits, establishing some things and saying, God, there's a foundation. This gospel's in good hands with me. This gospel's in good hands with this generation, because I'm taking hold of what's being handed to me, and I'm going to pursue it after for future generations. I'm pursuing after the things of God. I'm running after you. Draw me and I will run after you. Deep calls unto deep. And there is a deep undercurrent of the Holy Ghost that is moving in this place. I felt it from the moment that I walked into this place tonight. There is a depth that God wants you to go in the Spirit to get a hold of God all over again. We can become carnal in our nature. And oftentimes we think just checking a box of coming to church is just enough. But I don't want just walking through those doors to pacify me and say, God, I did my business. I did my duty for this week. Here I am, God. Now I want you to do something for me. No, I want to dig in the Spirit and say, God, I don't have a service to waste. I don't have a time to waste, but I want everything that you have for me. I want the process of adoption to be a continual renewing of the Spirit in my heart and in my life. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's stand tonight. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. God wants us to respond to the call tonight. And it's not just for those who always respond to the call. But maybe there's someone here, you've sat back and said, well, maybe that's for someone else. I'll wait till next time to do it. I'll let them pray the prayers for me because I have too much else going on in my life right now. God wants the Spirit of adoption to become powerful in your life tonight. Several years ago, in a village on the eastern side of Uganda in Africa, there was a lady named Agatha. She was working her daily job in the coffee fields. And as she was working, she heard the cries of a distant child. She began searching and found a little boy who'd been abandoned in the coffee field and left beneath the coffee bush. The little boy was left alone and nobody knew who he was or whose he was. Agatha at that moment decided to take the boy home and care for him. However, it was very difficult for her to care for him because she already had 8 children in her home. To make matters worse, her husband rejected the little child and wanted nothing to do with him. Agatha's husband became very violent towards this child and started to abuse this child. And this little boy had to live the very first year of his life in a very harsh and abusive situation. The family named this little boy James Mumwata, which Mumwata is a Ugandan word for trash, abandoned, dumped. Everywhere that this little boy went, he was called trash. He was referred to as abandoned or dumped. Mumwata. After about a year, Agatha could not take it anymore. She began to search for a new home for this little boy. There was a husband and wife who lived in Texas who wanted to adopt children. And they traveled all the way to Uganda to adopt this little boy, along with another girl from the western side of Uganda named Jolie. During the official adoption process, after Mumwata arrived in the United States, the new parents were given an opportunity in the courtroom, and they said, you now have the ability to change his name. They weren't going to let him be called trash for the rest of his life. And in that courtroom, he says this was such a powerful experience. They said, we changed his name to James William Akinundo Knight, which Akinundo in Ugandan means God hath chosen me. Oftentimes, the devil tries to attack you by calling you a name. He knows our real name, but he calls us by our sin. But God knows our sin. He knows everything about us. And God calls us by name. Romans 7 describes the conflict that goes on between the flesh and the spirit. I'm not going to go into all of it tonight, but he says, the good that I want to do, I'm not doing it. And those things that I don't want to do, I find myself continually doing it. And he's constantly talking about this wrestling match that's going on. I know I need to do these things, and I find myself not doing them. And I don't want to do these things anymore, but I find myself continually being drawn back to them. And many times in that scripture, he says, it's not me. That's not my identity. That's not who I am. Thankfully, in Romans 8 and 1, he says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. God knows our sin. He knows what frail, immoral people we are. But he says, I have put a name upon you. I know you by name, and I am your Father, and you have a name. Don't dwell on the ashes of your past mistakes. You have a future and you have a hope in God. And God wants to call you and use you to do great and mighty, powerful and wonderful things in his kingdom. Don't let the accuser of the brethren call you by your name or by your sin, but let God call you by your name. The devil wants to call you a liar because you've told lies in the past. He wants to call you a thief because maybe you've stolen. The devil wants to identify you as a drunk, as a druggie, a fornicator, an adulterer, a hater, an abuser, a backbiter, a gossiper, a talebearer, a curser, a doubter, a deceiver, a rebel, a backslider. But you don't have to live with that label on you. You can make a decision that I'm not going to be called by my sin, but I'm going to be called by his name. His banner over me is love, and he's given us his name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Your sin does not have to become your identity. Your mistakes in your life do not have to become your identity. But you can come before him and say, God, I know that you're able to wash away every one of my sins. And then he remembers your sin no more. And he looks in the Lamb's book of life, and all he sees is your name. We may remember Sarah as someone who laughed at the promises of God, but God remembers her as a woman of faith. We may remember Jacob as a supplanter and a deceiver, but God remembered him as Israel, a prince with God. We may remember Rahab as a harlot, but God remembers her as a hero. We may remember Mary of Magdalene as a promiscuous woman, but God remembers her as someone who washed his feet with precious ointment and dried them with her hair. We may remember him as the man with the withered hand, but God remembers him as the man whom he healed with the withered hand. We may remember Simon Peter as the betrayer, but God says, this is the man upon whom the kingdom is going to be preached. I'm giving you the keys to the kingdom. We may remember David as a murderer and an adulterer, but God calls him a man after his own heart. Our identity's in him tonight. Our identity is in him. It's not in the things of this world. It's not even in the things that we've done, but our identity is in Christ. If you want to say, God, I'm thankful for the name that you've put on me. I'm thankful for the name that you've given me. If you want that spirit of adoption to be made alive within you tonight all over again, I wonder if we could find a place to pray and say, God, I want that to be rebirthed in me. You don't have to be the same. You don't have to walk the same after tonight. Jacob, you're not that way anymore. But you're Israel. You are a prince with Christ. Hallelujah. I have a father tonight. I have a name. Hallelujah. 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 He's given me a name. I've been buried with him in baptism. I have a name that I can call upon. At a moment's time, I know God's going to hear me. I know God's going to respond because he is a very present help. In times of trouble, I'm not abandoned. I'm not abandoned. I'm not trash. I'm not refuse, but I have a name, and God cares about you tonight. You may feel lonely. You may feel isolated. You may feel separated, but God says, I care about you. I care about the fatherless. I care about the widowed. I care about the orphan. I care about you tonight. I care about the backslider. I care about those who've been cold in their spirit. I care about those who want more of me, who want more of the Spirit of God, who say, God, I'm not satisfied with where I am, but I want to know you more. Hallelujah. Deep's calling unto deep tonight. Deep is calling unto deep. Let the power of God work in you. Let the power of God strengthen you tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
What you call me.
I'll say yes.
I'll say yes.
Lord, I agree. My desire. Hallelujah. Is to be. Say yes to his will. Say yes to his ways tonight.
That's what I'll be.
Oh, I will be what you called
me to be.
I'll say yes. Hallelujah.
I'll say yes.
I'll say yes to your will. Yes to your ways, God.
Lord, I agree.
I want to follow after you. I want to know you more, God. I want to walk in your ways.